thank you, Dr. Kokla, for giving me a chance to participate in this course. As we all know, deep lamellar keratoplasty is a technique which is used for replacing the diseased stroma in conditions in which disease pathology is confined to the stroma and the endothelium is healthy. So we excise the unhealthy part of the stroma and replace it with new stromal tissue. There are a variety of indications, ectasias, stromal dystrophies, stromal infectious keratitis, certain selected ones, and of course corneal scars. So like I said, the pathology is usually confined to the stroma and the endothelium is healthy. And when we are doing a preoperative assessment of these patients, why it's important to do a preoperative assessment is for certain reasons. One is to see if these patients are really suitable cases for deep lamellar keratoplasty or not. Not every corneal scar is suitable for DALC. Some of them require penetrating keratoplasty. Whether the deep lamellar keratoplasty alone is enough or you require some additional procedures. What is the technique of deep lamellar keratoplasty that is going to be most suitable for this particular pathology? How large does your definition need to be? How large a graft you need to put? Do you need to anticipate any complications during this procedure? Can we assess that preoperatively that you are likely to have a rupture? And do you really need to go all the way down to the gaseous membrane, or can you just manage with an anterior or pre-desmetic type of a deep lamellar keratoplasty? So that's what you're trying to do when you're doing the preoperative assessment. So before you do anything else, first, whenever you're thinking that this is a case for DALC, try to get an idea whether this endothelium is healthy or not. If you are able to see the endothelial reflex in some part of the cornea that is clear, then it's a good idea if you can even get a specular image or do a specular reflection on your spectra. If not, you can have indirect evidence, look for any evidence of edema in the cornea. If there's no edema, that means the endothelium is likely to be healthy. Or if your pachymetry is normal, again that tells you that the endothelial function is good, so it's likely to be working well. So look, make sure that the endothelium is healthy. If your endothelium is looking somewhat doubtful, there's some edema in addition to the scar, then probably this case will not do well with just a deep lamellar keratoplasty and you may require a full thickness procedure. Another thing that many of us don't really look into is how good is the ocular surface. For any keratoplasty to survive and do well, the ocular surface has to be healthy. There should be enough lubrication in the tears. So make sure that you do a Schirmer's of evaluation of the tear film in some way or the other. Because if you don't have a good surface, then your graft is not going to take very well. It may start melting. You'll have surface problems and peel defects, and the graft may end up with a scar. If you feel that there is some doubt, there is some abnormality, it's not a bad idea to put temporary plugs intraoperatively along with the procedure. Just plug your puncta or the ampulla. You can also supplement the procedure with the amniotic membrane graft, which acts like a biological bandage contact lens. You could also add a tarsal feed along with the procedure of deep lamellar keratoplasty. It's important to understand how much of the cornea is involved in your disease pathology, and for that, of course, a good slit-lamp examination is often enough, and you can use the help of the diagnostic tools like the pachymetry map of the OCT or topography maps if it's an ectasia. So it's important that when you're excising the diseased tissue, you excise the entire diseased tissue. Particularly important for ectasias, if you leave behind some of the ectatic tissue, if it refines within the bone, then you will have ectasia at the graft host junction and you will really not benefit from the procedure. Depth of involvement is also important. You have to see how deep your scar is. If your scar is going very close to the desmoid membrane, then it's possible that it may be adherent to the desmoid membrane and during dissection you might end up rupturing the desmoid membrane. If the pathology is very superficial, say for anterior 100 microns or 120 microns, you could get away with doing a PTK or even an anterior lamellar procedure like a femtosecond assisted procedure or an ANTK, which will be talked about later. But if it's a deeper opacity, then of course you do need to require to do a deep stromal, deep anterior lamellar keratoplasty. Assess the severity of the thinning. How thin is it? And is it a peripheral thinning or a central thinning? Because that will help you choose the type of procedure that you want to do. extensively thinned out cornea, sometimes it may not be a good idea to do a deep lamellar, but do a big bubble type of deep lamellar plasty. If you have a peripheral thinning like in Pellucid, then again big bubble may not be very useful, because we know that the big bubble doesn't really go to the peripheral part of the cornea. It's only from less than about 8.5 meters in central cornea. So it's not really going to serve much of a purpose. And you might be better off doing a pre-desmetic type of deep lamellar keratoplasty. Of course, there are various instruments are available to assess thinning. Basically, a pachymetry map is always better compared to an ultrasound pachymetry, because that will tell you exactly the location of the thinnest point, and also you can quantify it much better and repeatedly go at the same point again. Also, it gives you the extent of the thinning. One particular point I wanted to make was, look, if you have a corneal scar, try to get an idea of whether this is a post-viral scar, and there are some indicators towards that. If the patient has history of recurrent episodes of redness, configuration of the scar, does it have a degenerative form shape, how the corneal sensations, are there any ghost vessels or vascularization, any liquid keratopathy, all of these are pointers that could have been old viral etiology. The reason I'm saying is, if you're doing deep lamellar keratoplasty in a post-viral scar, very often there's recurrence. My own hands, I think about 20-30% of post-viral diabetics do have some form of recurrence in viral pathology, either in the form of an ulceration or endophthalmitis. So in such cases, you always have to give a prophylactic antiviral cover. And if necessary, you can also, if there are a lot of blood vessels, like in this case, you can do a fine needle diathermy to preoperatively or even intraoperatively to try and block the blood vessels, so that you might avoid the possibility of an interface vascularization, which can be a problem. And this is, I think, one of the most important things that you have to do in the preoperative assessment. Look for any abnormality in the decimase membrane. If there is any scarring in the decimase, any thickening or irregularity of the decimase membrane, any discontinuity of the decimase membrane. For example, if it's a patient with keratoconus, he's had more eye drops, you may find any of these. And if you have any irregularity, then such a patient is probably not a good candidate for any form of decimatic dial, particularly the big bubble technique, which applies a lot of pressure on the decimase, and you might end up with a perforation and ruptured decimase membrane. So you have a high risk of decimase perforation. So avoid decimating that. You can go a little more anterior, probably a manual technique might be better in such cases. Finally, look beyond the cornea. Try to assess the patient. Is this patient going to be good for follow-up? Are they going to come for suture removal? If you don't take out sutures in time, sometimes you end up with vascularization and you end up having a failed tank, and you don't really do much of help to the patient. Is the patient a pediatric patient? Is there a likelihood of amblyopia? Will you require general anesthesia? I don't really do my dad's in GA, what some people do. So there can be some practical problems if you need GA. Systemic association should look for, they often overlook. If you are dealing with a keratoconus patient, specifically look for retinitis pigmentosa. You might just look at the cornea and not have a visual improvement if you miss the retinitis pigmentosa. Many of these patients have history of atopy. If you miss the atopy, your graft can start melting if your disease is active. And of course, you have to look at the other eye and treat the atopy before you do any surgical procedure. Amyloidosis is another thing which can be associated with certain dystrophies like lattice dystrophy. So look for that. So there's several other systemic associations, just to name a few. I think one of the most important tools that any lamellar corneal surgeon must have is access to an anti-segmental OCT. And that gives you, that helps you in many ways. It helps you assess the extent of the pathology, and it gives you an accurate assessment of the thinning. It tells you how thick the actual stroma is. So sometimes the epithelium may be thickened in certain areas, and you may think that the cornea is so thick, but the stroma is actually very thin. You will be able to identify decimase membrane irregularities, or even a small detachment of decimase because of the more eye drops. So look for any of these irregularities, because if you have something like this, then you don't want to do a desmetic there. So that's about the preoperative evaluation in lamellar keratoplasty. Surgical instrumentation. I don't use any special instruments for my deep lamellar keratoplasty. I just use routine penetrating keratoplasty instruments. And in addition, I use a universal cornea scissors to excise the stroma. Of course, you require a 26 gauge needle if you are doing a big double technique. However, you can use certain special instruments. Instead of using a simple handheld trifine, you could use one of the special trifines like the Hannah's, Hesburgh Baron, Moria, Coronet. The advantage is that you will be able to do a carded recognition, so you can go to the desired depth more accurately. You can use laminar dissectors. I don't use any specialized dissectors. I usually just use a number 15 BP plate, but you could use a Christian plate or any of the laminar dissectors from Petina, Moria, Dog. Or even a femtosecond laser, if you have access to it, you can do multiple passes, as has been shown by Dr. Roger Steiner. You can use a specialized instrument, Foglar's design survival instrument for big bubble. So I just use the needle to bend 27 gauge needle bevel down, you go to the right depth, injected the deep stroma, and the air finds its way through the deep stroma to the BDSMS space. But you could use some specialized instruments, Dr. Lewis. Pointed dissector can define the right plane to introduce a cannula, and this basically the cannula does the same job as a needle, but because it's a blunted instrument, it may be safer and has a port at the underside, which helps the air to get directed posteriorly in the pre-resonance space, so that you can get a good pin problem. You could also use some specialized instruments to help excise your stroma safely. Very often, it's during excision of the stroma that you end up rupturing the desmids. So, again, from Stowe's, Dr. Fogler has designed this trifacet spatula, which has a triangular cross section, and the apex of the triangle is facing up, so you can cut the stroma with a sharp instrument over it. You can also just use a spatula or another suppositor, that's what I use. You could use specialized scissors, like the scissors from Duckworth and Kemp, which Dr. Anwar has designed, or Dr. Fogler has designed these, on which one the lower limb of the scissor is longer and blunt, and you can excise the stroma quite safely without nipping the desmids membrane. Thank you.